Bonhoeffer, subtitled Pastor, Martyr, Prophet, Spy. Wow. Why Bonhoeffer? Why do you want to do this?
That's kind of a big question. Do we have some time?
Yeah, go ahead.
A few things. First of all, I never intended to write any biographies in my whole life, but I was asked to write a biography. In fact, right in this very spot here, I was having a conversation with an editor at HarperCollins who asked me to write a biography of William Wilberforce a few years ago. And I thought, well, I'm a writer. I've written books on apologetics. I've done all kinds of stuff. Never had an ambition to write a biography. But when he asked me, would you like to write a biography of Wilberforce, I thought, I think I would. And I prayed about it, and I wrote Amazing Grace. Inevitably, people asked me, Eric, who are you going to write about next? Who's your next biography going to be about? And I said, I never wanted to write one biography, much less two. But people kept asking the question. And I thought, there is only one person who has ever lived that I would feel called to spend the time to write about his life, and that is definitely Dietrich Bonhoeffer.
Why?
Bonhoeffer is a friend of mine at Union University in Tennessee has called Bonhoeffer a church father for the postmodern era. There's something about Bonhoeffer. He speaks to our generation. A friend of mine, Greg Thornberry at Union University in Tennessee, has called Bonhoeffer a church father for the postmodern era. There is something about Bonhoeffer. He speaks to us today in a way that I'm convinced no one does. Today, as Christians, we need role models. We need people. But there's something about Bonhoeffer. To me, he's the ultimate role model for Christians today. I believe that in writing this book, I've made available to Christians someone to whom we can look as a model of what is it to live in a time when what we believe is not really shared by the wider culture. I mean, that's an understatement in his case, but there is no one like Bonhoeffer. He was the real deal. There's also an authenticity to him which I think resonates with people today. We're tired of, you know, sort of religiosity. We want to see somebody who's the real deal. Bonhoeffer is the real deal in a way that literally no one I can think of is like him. So that's part of the reason.
Now, he didn't come out of a Christian background as such, did he? I mean, he came from German aristocracy. Privilege?
Well, no, his mother was quite a serious Christian. His father was an agnostic. His father was literally the most famous psychiatrist in Germany for the first half of the 20th century. Bonhoeffer's father, Karl Bonhoeffer, was one of the most famous scientists and doctors in Europe. So Bonhoeffer was raised in a family of academics, all geniuses. They were very, very well connected socially. They were culturally extraordinary. They all were musical virtuosos. They knew about painting. They knew about everything. And so Bonhoeffer was raised in a culture that was in some ways culturally very Christian, but his family culture was not. It's actually funny. There's a strange split. His mother and the two governesses that raised him were profoundly Christian. The rest of the family, not so much. They were not big churchgoers, but they didn't disdain it either. So they had kind of a his story, the way he was raised, it's pretty mixed, actually.
His experience with God, his Christianity, his commitment to God, was something that evolved. It didn't just happen overnight, right?
Yeah. Bonhoeffer's grandfather and great-grandfather on his mother's side were both theologians. So you take that, and then you take the fact that these two governesses that raised him and his mother, for whom he had a particular affinity, were quite serious in their faith. So somehow his heart turned toward God in a way that his brothers, who were sort of into science and stuff, did not. And then in World War I, his brother Walter was killed. That devastated the family. The mother was bedridden for a year, couldn't function. It really was a wound, and I think that it was then that the young Bonhoeffer, who had just turned 12, realized he wanted to go into theology. He also was very talented as a musician. They thought he might go into music professionally. Brilliant sight reader, musician on any number of levels. But he decided at age 12, 13 that he would go into theology. But he thought of it mainly as an academic discipline. In other words, just as his brother had distinguished himself in the world of physics, his brother worked with Max Planck and Einstein, split the atom. Just as his father had distinguished himself in brain chemistry and his other brother distinguished himself in the world of jurisprudence, Bonhoeffer was planning with this great ambition to distinguish himself, just like all the other Bonhoeffers, in the field of theology, to be a great theologian. But as great as he was in theology, and he was spectacular, I mean, you can read about it in the book, something happened when he came to New York around age 24 which deepened his faith, which changed his faith. And so that's kind of the second piece of it.
There was a great quote by Bonhoeffer in the book.
Just one, Scott?
Well, there are a number of them, but we have a limited amount of time here, and this is over 500 pages.
Is it really?
Yeah.
I guess then people will have to read the book. We'll let them read the book.
Here you go. Okay. It is much easier for me to imagine a praying murderer, a praying prostitute, than a vain person praying. Nothing is so at odds with prayer as vanity. Mm. Wow, what a statement.
This is the thing. The reason Bonhoeffer, the reason the book's long, Bonhoeffer is just one of the most rich, intense figures who has ever lived. There's so much to him. He wrote lapidary phrases like that in his sleep. I mean, he wrote whole books. Anybody read The Cost of Discipleship or Life Together? You can't underline, you want to underline every sentence. It's like mm-hmm. reading Chesterton or something. You get tired. You got to put the book down and you got to go lie down and rest because it's so intense. There was an intensity to him. He really knew who God was. Mm-hmm. And he expressed that over and over and over, but in so many different ways. That's why my greatest hope for this book is that it will lead people to read Bonhoeffer. It's just a treasure.
Now, you mentioned him coming to America.
Yeah.
We're in New York City now. The black community in this city
yeah.
had enormous effect on him.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, turned his life around
totally.
In many ways.
No question.
He visited a black church here. He couldn't find anyone that was preaching the gospel.
No, that's an understatement. He was disgusted with what he found in the mainstream Protestant pulpits of 1930. And this should be no surprise, but you were not hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ preached.
Yeah,
you were hearing watered-down modernist liberalism, which was what you were. That's what you would get in the mainstream pulpits in the Protestant churches.
Okay, another quote. In New York, they preach about virtually everything. Only one thing is not addressed, or is addressed so rarely, I have yet been able to hear it, namely the gospel of Jesus Christ, the cross, sin, forgiveness, death, and life.
Yeah.
That sounds like today.
That's 80 years ago he wrote those words about the state of mainstream Protestantism in New York City. We know that that has not changed. We know there's a tiny handful of churches, just like there was in his day, where they were preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Bonhoeffer, even the theological liberalism of Berlin was infinitely better than what he found here in New York. Here he found sloppy theology and bad theology. He might have disagreed with it in Berlin, but he respected the liberal theologians at Berlin. He didn't really respect the liberal theologians at Union. He was pretty disgusted, so
the
you
black
know what
church,
happened.
The he, effect he wandered, the black church had on him.
He met a fellow student named Frank Fisher, who was from Alabama, and Frank Fisher said, why don't we go up to Abyssinian Baptist Church? Frank Fisher had some work, social work, that he was doing for Union up at Abyssinian. So Bonhoeffer, this bespectacled, tow-headed German, goes up to Harlem, and for the first time in his life, he sees African Americans worshiping the gospel preached with fire, with power, by Adam Clayton Powell Sr. The worship blew his mind. He could not believe the worship that was there. He'd never seen anything. You can imagine, 1930, African American congregation. Everything about it touched his heart, moved him. He thought, for the first time, I've seen the gospel preached in America. Hmm. He decided to go back every single Sunday. He was here for many, many months, 9 months, and so he went every single Sunday, not just to worship, but to teach Sunday school. I think he also taught some adult Sunday school, so
this
he got very involved.
A white German in a black church at the beginning of the 1930s, right?
It's amazing.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
And he actually, I think, purchased a stack of what would have then been 78 records of the choir
he
singing,
searched,
the black churches, and took them back to Germany.
Yes, he searched, you know, the record shops of Manhattan to find these, what he called Negro spirituals, to take them back to Germany. Now imagine, as exotic as they were in New York, imagine in Germany, Germans listening to this. And over the next number of years, he shared this music, this great tradition of worship music, with all of the seminarians that he was teaching, all of these young Christians who were trying to learn what it is to be a Christian. He's like, well, I'll teach you what it is to be a Christian. Listen to this music. Listen to the worship. Listen to the heart, to the suffering, to the crying out to Jesus mm-hmm. Christ. You're not going to hear that. If you didn't think you'd hear it in mainstream Protestant churches in New York, you were certainly not hearing that in Germany. So this was a treasure, and he brought it back to Germany. And when he got back to Germany, everybody said, you're different. Something's happened to you. And Bonhoeffer goes so far as to say that it was then that I became a Christian. Something happened while he was here in New York that really deepened his faith and forced him not just to be a brilliant theologian, which he was, but to be a devout Christian, someone who was devoted to Jesus Christ, the person, the Lord.
And it had a tremendous effect on his life in terms of his how he viewed the second-class citizenry of the black community, the Negro community.
Right.
When he went back to Germany and equated that with then what became a driving force in his life, the Jews.
Well, the funny thing is that while he was here in New York, and he traveled in the South, he stayed with prominent African Americans down in Washington, D.C., he really was gripped by the whole idea of the racism and race relations in the U.S. He was following the Scottsboro case, which was 1931, really into this stuff. And he wrote in some letters back to his brother, I think, and there was no, in his mind and in his brother's mind, because his brother had been to the U.S. also, there was nothing to compare this to in Germany. In other words, this was an American problem. Of course, just a couple of years later, Hitler becomes chancellor in 1933, and everything changes. Suddenly now, Bonhoeffer is facing, in Germany, exactly what he saw here. He saw a group of people, the Jews, being made to be second-class citizens, and he was, from day one, vocally fighting against it, one of the few Christians who understood what he saw.
He had foreknowledge, is almost like a prophetic insight into what was coming in Germany in regard to Hitler.
I believe
he read
it was
it
prophetic.
Early out.
I believe it was a prophetic insight.
And it cost him.
It always does.
Yeah. To try to tell the German church, what became the Reich Church, that Hitler was evil, nobody was buying this.
It's a stunning thing to see how the churches and how the conservatives were co-opted and snowed by Adolf Hitler. Hitler was a genius in that he was profoundly cynical to the bottom, and he used the churches brilliantly. He was able to play them and to fight them, to sort of set up factions against each other. And the Germans, the Christians in Germany, somehow were really fooled by him until it was too late. Bonhoeffer was like a Cassandra, a voice crying in the wilderness, a prophet, a Jeremiah, I should say, in that he was calling the church to itself. He was calling the church to be the church. And we know what happens whenever a prophet is doing the work of a prophet. You're not rewarded. You don't get honorary doctorates for being prophetic. But he was a genuinely prophetic figure. There's no question.
What did the church do with him? How did it treat him then? The Reich Church, the German Church, the established Church, how did they respond to him?
Well, Bonhoeffer, of course, wasn't the only one to see some of these things. He was just the most radical. Bonhoeffer had a number of colleagues, people like Martin Niemöller and others, who understood that the German, sort of the established Church, of course we don't have that in the U.S., but the established Church, the Reich Church of Germany, was being Nazified. Nazi doctrines, which were taking over all of society, were also taking over the church. And people, really godly men, understood that this is not okay. But the funny thing is, most of them, including the wonderful Martin Niemöller, at first thought, Hitler's not behind this. This is just sort of the hardcore Nazis who have infiltrated the church, but Hitler will listen to reason. And they were really sure that they could work with Hitler and work with the Nazis and just get the Nazis to take their hands off of the church, having no idea that the very plan of the Nazis was to infiltrate the church, take over the church, remake it in their own image. So Bonhoeffer was one of the leaders of the Confessing Church, this group who understood that there was a problem. But even within the Confessing Church, he was almost alone in seeing the depth of the problem. He was always one step ahead, trying to get people to say, look, we've got to take a stand now. Don't you understand? We've got to take a stand now. And even his colleagues in the Confessing Church often thought, well, you're being a little too radical. You know, take it easy. This is, and he was always a step ahead and trying to rally them. And a few times he succeeded, but mostly he was alone.
Another issue that obviously came to the fore was identification with the gospel comes first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. Yeah. That cost him.
Well, it's interesting. Bonhoeffer, you know, he really was radical, and he really was a brilliant theologian because he was able to puzzle some stuff out, you know, to read Scripture and to say, you know what, according to this book, Jews and Christians, if we believe in Jesus, we stand as one together. Because we have to remember, there were many Jews in Germany who believed in Jesus, who went to church, who'd been converted the previous generation, two generations before, three generations before. So they were, their blood was Jewish, but they were culturally, religiously, in terms of their faith, they were Christians. Bonhoeffer was struggling with the fact that he had a dear friend, Hildebrandt, who was ethnically Jewish, but who was a minister, right? We have that in America, of course, Messianic Jews, of course. They're as Christian as any Gentile Christian. But the Nazis were so racially focused that their attitude is, if you have Jewish blood, you're a Jew, period. And listen, the Nazis didn't care about Christianity, whether you're a Gentile or a Jew. They didn't care about Christianity, and they didn't care about Judaism. They cared about race. They cared about if you had German blood or Jewish blood. So Bonhoeffer is reading the scriptures and trying to show his fellow Christians that in the church, there is neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither Jew nor Gentile. If a Jew wants to be a part of this church, we are obligated as Christians to welcome him in, to worship with him. This is the place, Bonhoeffer said, the church is the place where Jew and Christian stand together. Now, not only could the Nazis not see this, but many in the church could not see this. And we have to understand, in the United States, in the 30s, there were plenty white Christians who wouldn't think of worshiping cheek by jowl with an African-American Christian. So it's very easy for us to say that, oh, the Germans, you know, they wanted the Jews to worship in their own church if they were Christian Jews. But guess what? We had that here. So that, to me, the history of Germany, it's interesting because it does speak to us in a number of ways. It forces us to think through what we really believe.
And that, as the persecution of the Jews came to the fore,
yeah,
and he identified with them, how? How did he speak to that in the context of what Germany became and the confessing church?
There are many connections between Bonhoeffer and the Jews. First of all, on the most simple level, Bonhoeffer was raised in a family of academics in Grunewald, which is this sort of elite area of Berlin. Half of his neighbors were Jewish academics. Half of his neighbors were friends. And so, again, his family was not so religious that they didn't spend time with Jews. They were a very sophisticated, urban family. So he had friends who were Jewish. His sister, Sabina, married a Jewish man.
Twin sister.
His twin sister, Sabina, the woman he was closest to, the person in the whole world, he was closer to his twin sister, Sabina, than anybody. She married a Jewish man. Now, again, believed in Jesus, but he was ethnically Jewish. So his connections on a personal level, he knew so many Jewish people. As I said, his best friend, Franz Hildebrandt, who was a pastor, was Jewish. So Bonhoeffer had all these friends who were Jewish. And then Bonhoeffer, of course, did a lot of traveling. So he didn't have such a parochial view that to be a Christian is to be a Lutheran, is to be a German. He had been to Rome. He'd been to the United States. He traveled around. He had ecumenical contacts. He understood that the Church of Jesus Christ obliterates national identity, racial identity. He understood that. And he really, he had a different view theologically. He had a more sophisticated biblical view, let's put it that way, theologically. And so he understood that he's in this lonely position of getting God's heart for his people, God's heart for the chosen people. At Kristallnacht, this is a sort of famous thing in the book, where at Kristallnacht, even many of the seminarians who were very close to Bonhoeffer still thought, oh, this horrible thing that's happened to the Jews, it's part of the curse of the Jews. Even though they were not themselves against Jews, it was so much a part of German culture to think of things this way. And Bonhoeffer made it very clear, no, it's not. There's not a curse on the Jews. And he was very clear, actually. He wrote a circular letter to all of his seminarians quoting certain passages. I go through the whole thing, chapter and verse, in my book, where he's basically saying that what the Nazis have done to the Jews in Germany, they have done to God's people. These are God's people. The burning of the synagogues, this is an attack on God. This is an attack on God's people, on Christians, on Jews. I mean, it was a leap. To make that leap as a German at that time, it was a dramatic leap.
So as a pastor, as a prophet, a spy.
How
did he become a spy?
It's pretty interesting. Bonhoeffer, so he was in the middle of this battle, fighting for the church, fighting for Germany. Things continued to get worse. We know in 1938, Hitler is making war. Any day, they're going to go to war. So 1939 comes around, and Bonhoeffer realizes he will be drafted. He cannot fight in Hitler's war. Now, he was not a pacifist. People sometimes have tried to characterize him as a pacifist. I don't really see much evidence for that, particularly in these years. But he would not fight in Hitler's war. He knew who Hitler was, and he thought, I've got to get out of it somehow. So he goes back to the United States of America. He decides to go to Union, to take a post as a teacher or something like that, because he wants to get away from Germany, in a sense. It's very simple. He decides he's going to try to get away from Germany. He comes here, and this is, I go through this in the book, it's an amazing period. It's never been covered as completely as I do in my book, but he's seeking the will of God, and the Lord calls him back to Germany. He knew, I will have no peace. He only stayed here in New York 26 days the second time. People think, oh, he was here for a while. He was hoping to be here 3 years, then he thought maybe a year. 26 days, he goes back. And the question is, now, to answer your question, he's going to go back to Germany. What's he going to do? He's a pastor. He's a theologian. What will he do? Well, Bonhoeffer's family were all very, very involved in the conspiracy against Adolf Hitler. His whole family knew, even those who were not seriously Christian, they knew from day one that Hitler is evil. Hitler is the ultimate anti-German. He's going to destroy Germany, everything that this great nation has been, this vulgar, maniacal monster is destroying. So when Bonhoeffer goes back to Germany in 39, he's going back just to spend time with his family. He's spending time with people who are already involved in the conspiracy against Hitler. He had been providing them moral support. But this was the moment of decision. Do I take another step? Do I now get involved myself in the conspiracy? Theologically, he felt that God led him to do that, that he must do it. I won't go into why because we don't have the time. But what he did was, his brother-in-law was one of the leaders of what's called the Abwehr, which is German military intelligence. German military intelligence was, again, a center of the conspirators against Hitler. All of these generals, Prussian aristocrats, many of them Christians, despised Hitler. And they were located in German military intelligence. The Gestapo, of course, just the opposite. So there was this cat and mouse game between the Gestapo and the Abwehr. Bonhoeffer had it arranged that the Abwehr would hire him to be a member, ostensibly, of German military intelligence, furthering the aims of the fatherland during wartime, using his ecumenical contacts all around Europe for the Nazi cause. Of course, we know, and Bonhoeffer knew, and his leaders in the Abwehr knew, that's just cover for what you're really going to do. What you're really going to do, because you're a pastor with ecumenical contacts, we can say that you're doing this for the German government, but what you're really doing is you're going to make contact. You're going to go to Sweden, you're going to go to Switzerland, to these neutral countries to make contact with the Allied forces. You are going to be the man who goes to make contact with people who have connections to Churchill's government, to other governments, to get word out that there's a group of conspirators inside Germany fighting to have Hitler killed and to take over the government. So
which Churchill never bought into, did he?
It's really heartbreaking. Yeah, in my really book, is, one of the saddest things of the book is to see how Churchill and his minister, Anthony Eden, just would not give the time of day either to Bonhoeffer or to the others who were reaching out. It's heartbreaking.
Right. This ultimately brought Bonhoeffer to the place where he had it absolutely resolved in his mind, philosophically, spiritually, biblically, that he could justify being involved in a direct assassination plot was the ruling governing authority at the time. Now,
that's right.
How did he resolve that with, say, Bible verses, Romans 13, that said you're supposed to obey those in authority?
Sure.
How did he work that through?
Again, I think if you think about it even just for a moment, you realize there's no conflict. I mean, I pay my taxes for cops and for military. Well, why do they have guns? To kill. Why do they have guns to kill? Well, it's not to be murderers. I don't give my taxes so that cops can murder. I give my taxes so that cops and so that members of the military can protect the innocent. We believe that God has instituted godly authorities to protect the innocent. That's part of what was going on here. Bonhoeffer understood that, and by the way, I should say he was so connected through his family and through the Abwehr, he knew what was happening to the Jews. Many Germans had no idea. And if you had told them and argued with them, they would say, you're crazy. We would never do that.
And some of them refused to see it.
Well, of course. But I'm saying, but even many good Germans had no idea what was really going on. But Bonhoeffer knew. And he thought, if I, as a Christian, am unwilling to get my hands dirty to protect scores of thousands and millions of innocent Jews, I will not be able to stand before a holy God. He knew this. And to have some fussy theological argument about, well, do I do this again? He understood it's like watching somebody butcher children in the other room and say, you know what? I can't do anything. I can't kill, but I'm going to go pray about it. Only a coward would do that. And of course, there are plenty of Christian cowards. There are plenty of people that say, like, well, I don't want to get involved in that. It's just my job to evangelize. It's just my job to pray. Well, guess what? Sometimes God requires you in obedience to take action. Bonhoeffer felt, I'm obeying Jesus Christ. I'm not going out on a limb by myself. God forbid. I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. And if he would have me dirty my hands by getting involved in this, I might not want to, but I will. And he did.
Perhaps another title for this man is one that's interesting that you bring up in the book.
Yeah,
he was a romantic. I don't know how many people knew that he actually had fallen in love twice in his life.
Yeah.
And then near the end of his life, a woman that he was engaged to.
Yeah.
And that they were going to be married. And how important a role she played in his life as well.
People have been reading about Bonhoeffer for years, and you hear, wasn't he engaged to somebody? Never before, until my book, amazingly, has the story been told. He never thought he would marry. I mean, he'd been engaged to somebody years before, and you never hear anything about that. I put all that in the book as well. But then he gets involved in this incredible battle, the Third Reich, and all this stuff, and he's sure, I'm just serving God, I'm not going to marry. And at age 36, he meets an 18-year-old woman and knows, somehow, this is the one. And it was such a difficult time. I mean, this is right before he's arrested. Her parents were against it because she was only 18, and who is this 36-year-old? And, you know, he's doing this hugger-muggery with the Gestapo and the military intelligence, and he could get arrested and killed, and we don't want her involved. And it's a story of passionate romance. It's a beautiful story. It's just a huge part of his life. So I'm thrilled, really thrilled, that my book, for the first time, literally, I tell the story of his romance.
He believed that they would be married. Unfortunately, or in the sovereignty of God, he was arrested and put in prison. Why?
Well, to understand the facts, it's a little more complicated than what you'd think of. He was not put in prison for trying to kill Hitler. He was arrested in the spring, in April of 1943, for effectively a money laundering crime. He was involved, through the Abwehr, definitely, the military intelligence, in trying to get a number of Jews out of Germany to safety. To do this in the Third Reich, of course, was a high crime, but it was not anything compared to getting involved in the plot to kill Hitler. So he was arrested. He was sent to Tegel Military Prison. His uncle was the military commandant over all of Berlin. So going to Tegel Military Prison, he had a friend in high places. So he was treated with great deference by the guards. In fact, he was disgusted by how they treated him differently because his uncle was the Berlin military commandant. So Bonhoeffer was treated well during those months. Of course, he was extremely unhappy to be in prison while his fiancée is out there. They're writing letters. She would visit him about once a month. His family, of course, would visit him. But he was not in grave danger during this time, even though he was in prison. And he was doing everything he could to get out. He couldn't wait till the trial. He thought he'd be exonerated and so on and so forth. But he was still in prison. July 20th, 1944, the Stauffenberg plot, of course, fails. The bomb goes off, does not kill Hitler. And now the entire conspiracy, which has been working for on and off for practically 10 years, is completely exposed. At that moment, of course, Bonhoeffer's days are numbered. All the people involved in the conspiracy are tortured and imprisoned and killed, and names come out. Bonhoeffer's name was one of them. He was then transferred to the Gestapo prison, much more draconian, horrible situation. Later on, he was transferred to Buchenwald concentration camp. He was held as a prisoner in some barracks there. And of course, in April of 1945, on the direct orders of Hitler, he was hanged, killed for his involvement in the plot.
And how close was this to the end of the war?
Bonhoeffer was killed on April 9th. Hitler killed himself less than 3 weeks later. The war ended about 3 weeks later. Bonhoeffer could hear the American guns in the distance closing in. I mean, any day the Americans would have arrived to liberate them. But Hitler was, to the bottom, a petty man, and he wanted revenge, and he wanted all those who were involved in the plot to kill him to die themselves. It's really tempting for us to look at this as a great tragedy. It's so sad. But I think that Bonhoeffer himself would rebuke us for having that point of view. And he would say, yes, there's a sadness, but to serve God with everything you have unto death is the greatest joy of life. God gave me life, and if I can give him my life, He'll give it back to me. We know this. And Bonhoeffer preached a sermon. I quote this right at the end of the book. In 1933, he preached a sermon about death and how faith in Jesus Christ transforms death, so that this thing that we shrink from, this horror, is transformed, that it is a passageway to the realm of the resurrected, to the place that God has prepared for us, this paradise. Bonhoeffer believed that in the bottom of his bones. He believed this. So I'm convinced that he went to the gallows with peace and even with joy. In fact, I quote this as well, someone who observed him, this doctor who had seen many, many people go to their deaths, said he had never seen anyone go to his death with the peace and submission to God that he saw in Bonhoeffer. He didn't even know who Bonhoeffer was at the time. So there's a different side of the story.
What's the message of his legacy to 21st century Christians or non-Christians? I mean, to the world at large. What is he saying to us?
Well, I would say fundamentally, I would say first to people who are not Christians, that if you have not experienced Bonhoeffer, if you don't know his story, I would say try Bonhoeffer, because he, to me, is the one person that somehow, because of the way he lived with such integrity and such authenticity in his faith, that he really can lead people who have doubts about faith to faith. I really believe that. I think that he is somebody that when you come in contact with Bonhoeffer, you say, you know what, I've never seen that before. Everybody else, there's something about Bonhoeffer. So I would say for me, he's the ultimate witness to a world that is not Christian, that he calls people to God with an authenticity that is literally, in my experience, unique. To Christians, it's sort of everything else. I don't think there's anybody like Bonhoeffer, and that's why I spent so much time writing this book. I think that there's an authenticity to him which you just don't see. There's something about his life. One thing I really want to say, which I almost forgot, Bonhoeffer has in many ways been hijacked by people who are theologically on the liberal end of things, especially those folks in the 50s or 60s who somehow, and this is just insane, they thought of him as the sort of this apostle of the quote-unquote God is dead movement, because Bonhoeffer once said something in a letter about religionless Christianity, okay? Now, it's almost funny if it weren't so sad, but their misinterpretation of what he meant by that is spectacular. Bonhoeffer, by religionless Christianity, meant precisely the opposite of what they thought he said. By religionless Christianity, he meant true radical Christianity, not mere religion, not a fig leaf, but the blood of Jesus Christ. Mm. The blood of Jesus Christ can redeem us from sin. Mere religion, dead religion, is a fig leaf. It's a joke. It's an attempt to lie to God, to fool God into thinking that if I do all these little things, I can earn my way into heaven. Bonhoeffer saw that that's what passed for religion, for faith, for Christianity in Germany, and it failed Germany. When it stood the ultimate test of the evil of Hitler and the Nazis, it failed. And he, in his last days, writing a letter to a friend, writes about, we failed. We need somehow a new Christianity that is the real thing, because we have failed, and we need to have Jesus as Lord over everything, not over this little religious sphere where we do our little things and go to church, but Jesus' Lordship is meant to be over everything, over the Gentile and the Jew, over the believer and the non-believer, over every sphere. Jesus is Lord over all. That is religionless Christianity in a nutshell. And it's a very, very important thing for us to understand that this man was a prophet of God, and he was utterly obedient to the Lord. His theology was utterly orthodox, and that's, to me, the great irony is that, as I say, his theological legacy has been confused. So for me, the joy of this book, the joy of telling the story, is to rediscover Bonhoeffer for a generation that never knew him. We all, in many ways, I should say most people, have a kind of a confused view of Christianity, and sometimes God sort of appoints times, and I think that now is the time for the church, in this particular time, to be inspired by this man who lived through things and who can be a leader for us and a model for us living through what we're living through today.
Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the real thing.
The real thing.